Hey guys, this is Dan with Anodizing. In this video, I'll be showing you how to anodize aluminum parts at home or in your shop. So the process we'll be using is called type 2 anodizing, which is also referred to as sulfuric or color anodizing. All right, so anodizing is basically a process of creating a protective oxide layer on your aluminum parts. Normally, aluminum does create a natural oxide layer, but anodization basically speeds up that process. So with type 2 anodizing, we're going to speed it up using an acid bath and a power supply. So this will create a protective layer on your parts. It'll be a hard layer, which is really durable and scratch resistant, and it's also resistant to corrosion. So cool thing about type 2 anodizing is it allows you to dye the parts, because the protective coating is somewhat porous, and so it absorbs dye really well. So you can see I've got a whole bunch of different colored parts using different dyes. So going in order, we've got the royal blue, the red, or scarlet. This was the charcoal gray, and this is the pearl gray, and then this was just clear anodization. The dye that I use is just a basic general purpose fabric dye. I use the RIT or Wright brand. These cost a couple bucks a piece, so super affordable. You can pick these up at Walmart, Hobby Lobby, Michaels, kind of wherever your craft supply stores are. You can also get them on Amazon, so I'll post a link in the description below. All right, so the next important thing I want to cover is safety. This is sulfuric acid in a concentrated form, and even in dilute form, it's definitely very dangerous. You don't want to get it on your skin, you don't want to get it in your eyes, you don't want to inhale it. Definitely dangerous stuff, you got to be really careful with it. So I'm going to go over some safety precautions. One of the most important ones will be safety goggles. You want goggles that fully wrap around, not just your standard safety glasses like this. These are better than nothing, but they, you can still get splashes under the eyes with those glasses. So something that wraps all the way around, you can see I'm protected from splashes in all directions, and this also helps with any fumes getting into my eyes. Another really important thing is going to be rubber gloves, or these nitrile gloves, disposable gloves. Another important thing is a respirator with an organic compound filter. This will protect your lungs and your throat from the fumes that the acid creates. So especially once you get this process going, it's going to create a lot of stinky fumes that you just really don't want to be breathing. The last thing is going to be some sort of protective clothing. Ideally, you'd wear like a Tyvek apron with some protective sleeves, or some kind of lab coat, something like that. You'll see in the video I'm just wearing an old cotton button-up shirt with long sleeves, which is probably not ideal, but it's better than nothing. So yeah, just make do the best you can with what you've got. All right, so I'll be using sulfuric acid, which is currently in this bucket. I've mixed it up to about 9% concentration, which is probably a little bit low. You wanna shoot for 10 to 15%, but I needed about a gallon of it to be able to dip my parts in, and I bought a 1-quart bottle, so I did a 3-to-1 mix ratio. So the concentration on this stuff is about 36%. Doesn't say that anywhere in the bottle, but what it does tell you is the SG, or specific gravity, which is 1.265. So based on that specific gravity, I was able to look that up and determine what the percent concentration was. So yeah, I think that covers all the basics, so let's go ahead and get started. All right, so now we're gonna go over some of the materials. All this stuff will be linked in the description below. So first of all, you're going to have some titanium wire. This is one of your electrodes and also is a way to fix your parts. So you can see here, I've got these parts fixtured. They're ready to hang in the acid bath. All I did to do that is bent the wire into a little loop. So it's just kind of a friction fit inside the hole. So I've got it in a non-conspicuous spot. So that way, I won't have a spot where you can see, oh, that's where the fixture is touching the part. So that's kind of the first thing. Next, we're going to have a power supply with variable current. So you can see when I turn this on, it's got a current reading and a voltage reading. Right now it's zero current because I have no load hooked up to it. So the next thing is this bucket, which has about 10 or 11% sulfuric acid. So I've diluted standard battery acid, which comes in a bottle like this. So I did 1 quart of battery acid with 3 quarts of distilled water to get that exact concentration. And inside this bucket, I've got a piece of aluminum. This was originally anodized aluminum, so I had to soak it in some lye to remove that anodization. So that way it'll make a good electrode for this process. And then also in this bucket, I've got a, this is just an air pump for a fish tank. So what that's gonna do is just break up the surface tension and just keep the water agitated so that no bubbles form on the parts and we get a nice consistent coating. So you can see I've got the air pump right here. So I'll hook that up once I get going. But yeah, that's kind of it for the anodizing process. I guess the last thing is this piece of PVC pipe that I made. So that'll go over the top of the bucket, give me a nice surface to hang my parts from. All right, next I've got some buckets over here. So this one in the back is distilled water with some baking soda. That's for rinsing the acid off the parts. And then I've got some simple green right here. That's about a 4-to-1 mix ratio. That's to degrease my parts before anodizing. And then lastly, I've got this bucket of lye here. So this is just Drano. I actually got this at the dollar store. That was the cheapest thing I could find. But it seems to work pretty well. So that basically just etches your parts and removes any impurities or, you know, in the case of my electrode, I was able to remove the previous anodization. So also, supposedly, if you mess up your process, you can always go back and soak your parts in a bucket of lye and get that anodization off and start over. I should also mention that lye is also very caustic and you don't want to get it on your skin. So be very careful with that, avoid splashes, and wear proper PPE at all times. All right, now it's time to set things up. So this is an electrode. This is for that aluminum electrode that I was talking about. Just using a drywall anchor and a piece of copper wire. And so then that's hooked up to our banana jack connector here, which will go into the power supply. Next, I'm going to grab my PVC pipe. I'm gonna set that up like this. And then we'll put these in first, and then we'll stick this one in last. So now I'm gonna plug the negative in. So the negative is what's hooked up to our big electrode, and then the positive is what hooks up to our parts. So I'm gonna go ahead and clip this on one of the wires, and then I made this jumper to clip onto the other one. Okay, so that looks good. Looks like everything is fully submerged. So now I can turn power on. I'm shooting for about 1.9 amps. So I'm going to adjust the current and the voltage until I get there. That should be close enough. So you can see there, the big electrode is producing a lot of bubbles. And then you see some starting to form on the parts as well. See that there. Alright, so now I got my pump hooked up, so you can see that's just creating some agitation. So I'm going to let these parts sit for about, I think I calculated 20 minutes, so we'll come back in a little bit. Alright, here we go. So I got power turned off. Now I'm disconnecting my electrodes. So first I'm going to take this one. So very first step, I'm going to take it over to the baking soda water. Alright, get all that acid neutralized. Now I'm going to dip it in the gray solution. And then we'll do the same thing with these. Alright, this one I'm going to do one of each color. So I'm going to do this, and we'll see how that turns out. Now these parts look a lot better. Pretty happy with how these turned out. So you can see it's not the most vibrant blue. But that gray actually turned out kind of cool. It's not quite like the, for comparison, this was the charcoal gray before. So you can see they're similar, but the pearl gray is definitely a little bit lighter and definitely more gray, not quite as reddish brown. So yeah, I think those turned out pretty cool. All right, so a couple of final thoughts. Now I've anodized a few parts. I did these parts in the video, and then I've done these parts as well. Which I showed earlier on. I would say probably the two most important steps are cleaning and rinsing your parts. So you want to rinse in between, basically in between each new solution that you dip the parts in. So you're going to start out by washing in a degreaser like Simple Green to get all the oils and stuff off your parts, and then you're going to rinse them and then go into a lye solution to etch, and then you'll rinse again. After that, you'll go into the acid bath to start anodizing, and then after that, you'll rinse in the baking soda water to neutralize the acid, and then after that, they'll go into the dye to add the color. I would say one extra step that I did not show in the video is I would recommend doing a pre-rinse before going into the boiling water to seal the parts. So you can see just how colored that water got, hopefully that's showing up in the video. But yeah, if you don't do that, that's going to end up in your boiling water, and then that's especially important if you've got multiple colors that you're doing at once. They're all just going to bleed together if you just keep dipping them straight into the boiling water. So getting some of that dye off on a pre-rinse before going into the boiling water is probably a good idea. But yeah, overall, I'm really happy with how these parts turned out. This process was super cool, super easy to set up, really didn't cost very much at all. Did the whole thing for under $150. And yeah, it's pretty well contained. You know, you can just put lids on your buckets and store them and take them out when you need to use them again. So that works out pretty well. But yeah, hopefully this video was helpful. Hopefully you learned something. If you have any questions, comment down below. If you have any advice for me or for other people doing this process, comment that down below as well. That'll be helpful for anyone else watching. So yeah, again, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed.